In the 1500s and 1600s, the work of Copernicus and Galileo, among many others, reshaped how natural philosophers in Western Europe thought about the question, where are we? But there's another question to consider that is at least equally daunting. What is life? And to try and answer that question, three tools stand out as being especially useful. A really long book of beautifully grotesque illustrations based on dissected bodies, experiments about blood pumping through living animals, and the microscope. You could call Andreas Vesalius the Copernicus of anatomy. His name has become synonymous with a revolution of its own, and his major book even came out in 1543, the same year as De Rev. Vesalius was born in Brussels in 1514. He studied at the universities of Leuven, Paris, and Padua. He wrote his thesis about Al-Raz, the famous and prolific medieval physician who wrote Doubts About Galen, and Vesalius did some Galen doubting of his own. After conducting years of medical research, Vesalius wrote up his findings in a gigantic seven-volume book with 273 illustrations. It was published in 1543 under the name De Humani Corporis Fabrica, or get this, on the fabric of the human body. And it redefined the long Hippocratic, Galenic, Arabic, Persian medical tradition. And it didn't just tweak Galen's ideas. Fabrica was a new way of doing medicine. A new paradigm. The seven books of Fabrica cover the bones and cartilage, the ligaments and muscles, the veins and arteries, the nerves, the heart, the brain, and the organs of nutrition and generation, meaning most of the rest of the stuff in the body. And along the way, it brims with observations that were new to Vesalius's world. Vesalius accurately described the sternum, the bones of the arm, the skull, and the entire muscular system. Importantly, he also wrote that the brain and nerves are the center of the mind. This overturned the Aristotelian idea that the heart was the center of thought and feeling. And despite possible religious objections, Vesalius disproved the belief that men had one rib fewer than women. He even disproved the idea from Galen that men have more teeth than women. Seems like fairly easy things to do. No one had thought to look inside of a woman's mouth. That's just way too weird. How are you gonna study a woman? Where are they? In fact, Vesalius realized that many of Galen's observations made back in Roman times when human dissection was illegal had actually been observations of animals, not humans. Galen incorrectly thought the human lower jaw was made of two bones, like it is in some animals. He thought that the major blood vessels started in the liver, and he thought that the human body had a network of blood vessels at the base of the brain called arete mirabella that are actually found in dolphins and sheep. But Vesalius was able to correct a lot of these misconceptions thanks to the big innovation he used in his lectures at Padua. Dissection. Instead of hiring a surgeon to do his dirty work, Vesalius, a scholar, conducted dissections himself. Thought bubble, show us the wonder of hands-on medical observation. Fabrica is written as a sort of guide to dissecting someone. Vesalius clearly explains the order in which you have to dissect a body to observe each muscle. He lets you know what tools you need. So Fabrica shows how important instruments are to scientific knowledge making. And over the course of thousands of pages, you see that Vesalius begins to think about the human body as a composite of physical, mechanical, interlocking systems, not a bag of humors. In some ways, anatomy in the modern sense begins with Fabrica. The book wasn't just an encyclopedia of diseases and treatments, it was a guide for seeing the body anatomically instead of humorally. And Vesalius wanted others to see what he saw. His book's illustrations were made possible by advances in artistic techniques and the improvements of detailed woodcut engraving as a technology. And Vesalius supervised the whole process carefully. He wrote out such specific instructions for his printer that the printer included them in the text. Chances are you have seen some of the dissection-inspired woodcuts from Fabrica. Flayed human bodies traipse through a stylized Italian countryside, making dance-like motions, demonstrating how their muscles and bones connect, and looking not too bad for people with no skin. Thanks, Thought Bubble. Where Vesalius helped readers of his book see the human body differently, they would still have many questions about what life is and how it functions. William Harvey answered one of the big ones. How does blood work? Harvey was born in Kent, England in 1578. He studied in Italy, was a fellow at the Royal College of Physicians in London, gave popular lectures on anatomy, and served as physician to King James I. He also was a major skeptic when it came to witchcraft, which was the source of much freaking out at the time. So as an official examiner of witches, which was a thing that you could be back then, he acquitted the accused rather than having them burned alive. But William Harvey was most famous for his theory of blood circulation, which Galen and Vesalius both got wrong. Like Vesalius, Harvey learned a lot about bodies through careful observation, also known as getting all gross. He did this specifically through vivisection, or cutting open live animals. He watched their hearts slow down and finally stop beating as they died, and he estimated the amount of blood that left those exposed hearts. And he used those measurements for a reason, to help him formulate medicines. In doing so, Harvey helped bring the idea of rigorous measurement to medical investigation. And by 1618, Harvey had arrived at the conclusion that arterial and venous blood vessels form a single connected closed circulatory system. This was a brand new idea. Harvey published his findings in 1628 in another Latin language classic, which sounds a little bit like you're casting a spell when you say it. Exhortatio anatomica de motu cordis et sanguinis in animalibus. Or on the motion of the heart and blood, which historians tend to shorten to de mortu cordis, which is definitely the name of my new metal band. De motu cordis was again a revolt against the old Aristotelian Galenic system. It's also a great early example of comparative anatomy. Harvey compared the hearts and arteries of many cold-blooded animals in order to understand the basics of how a heart pumps blood, or really, that a heart does pump at all, as opposed to the blood diffusing through the system, as Galen thought. Through his quantitative experiments, Harvey disproved the Galenic idea that the liver creates the blood found in veins, and Harvey figured out that blood flows in one direction at a time, thanks to valves, also not part of Galen's system. But while Harvey's de motu cordis was a more accurate theory of how blood circulates than Galen's, Harvey also fudged his data in order to make his point. When he measured a heart, Harvey estimated the volume of liquid it could hold, how much blood it moved each time it beat, and the number of beats it made in half an hour. And Harvey made each of these estimates intentionally low so that people could easily see how wrong Galen's liver-based system was. The liver simply couldn't make enough blood fast enough for the diffusion theory to work, but he made sure the numbers didn't come even close. Now still, to his credit, Harvey did all of that observation and experimental work without a critical instrument that would soon be developed over in the Low Countries. The microscope. Anton Philips van Leeuwenhoek was born in Delft in what was then the Dutch Republic in 1623. The inventor of the microscope became the so-called father of microbiology because you can't have a microbiology without a microscope, another example of the importance of instrumentation to scientific knowledge making. We don't have all the details of what process van Leeuwenhoek used to create his invention, but we do know that he made hundreds of magnifying lenses and at least 25 proper microscopes. Somewhere along the line, Leeuwenhoek told a doctor friend about his investigation of the very small, and that friend told the Royal Society over in England. In 1673, the Philosophical Transactions of the Royal Society published van Leeuwenhoek's microscope-enabled observations. A few years of debate then ensued about whether van Leeuwenhoek was pulling everybody's collective natural philosophical chain, but members of the Royal Society eventually confirmed his findings. Using his invention, van Leeuwenhoek discovered an entire world of amazing forms in miniature. He found single-celled organisms living their best lives at an entirely different scale than our own. He called these animalcules, or little animals, many of which weren't actually animals. For example, in 1677, van Leeuwenhoek observed spermatozoa, and in 1682, he observed muscle fibers. Over the years, he wrote hundreds of letters to the Royal Society and similar institutions to share his observations, but he never divulged the secret of his microscope manufacturing. Jerk. Another Dutch natural philosopher combined the work of van Leeuwenhoek and Vesalius. Jan Swammerdam was born in Amsterdam in the Dutch Republic in 1637, and yes, I said that without laughing. He delicately dissected animal and plant tissues under a microscope, learning in the process about both the structure and the development of life. This was a critical turn in the life sciences. Swammerdam observed, for example, how an insect changes from an egg into a wiggly larva, then a hibernating pupa, and then finally an adult, often capable of flight, four different bodies, one single animal. Swammerdam also experimented on muscle contraction, and in 1658 he was the first to observe a red blood cell. All told, 17th century Holland was a rad time to be a natural philosopher asking what is life, as long as you can get your hand on one of van Leeuwenhoek's microscopes, which apparently only 26 people could. But perhaps the greatest early microscopist was the English polymath Robert Hooke, born on the Isle of Wight in 1635. Hooke became the curator curator of experiments of the Royal Society and did a whole bunch of amazing work in science that we'll have to explore some other time. For now, just go Google Micrographia. This is the book Hooke published in 1665, which is the first book of microscope-enabled observations of the natural world, and arguably the first scientific bestseller. It's also the first instance of the word cell being used to describe a single chamber within a living tissue, like the cell or small confined quarters inhabited by a monk. Like Vesalius, who was obsessed with woodcuts, and Van Leeuwenhoek, who was a manic letter writer, Hooke wanted others to see the living world how he saw it. So Micrographia is full of beautiful, tattoo-worthy illustrations, including a famous one of the homely flea. In fact, it's so beautiful that it's easy to forget that even though it was a scientific rendering, it was still highly subjective. After all, seeing nature through a device like a microscope or a telescope doesn't make you free from biases, and the microscope raised more questions than the slightly older telescope because it required even more subjective interpretation. With only a few good microscopes around in Hooke's day, most readers of Micrographia could not have confirmed the accuracy of Hooke's drawing of a flea or anything else in that book. They just had to trust in the authority of the professional scientist, one of the first in his society. Next time, we'll follow the so-called explorers from Eurasia as they travel throughout the Americas and Africa, pillaging, classifying, and mostly pillaging. Stay tuned! Crash Course History of Science is filmed in the Dr. Cheryl C. Kinney studio in Missoula, Montana, and it's made with the help of all of these nice people, and our animation team is Thought Cafe. Crash Course is a Complexly production. If you want to keep imagining the world complexly with us, you can check out some of our other channels like Healthcare Triage, How to Adult, and SciShow Psych. And if you would like to keep Crash Course free for everybody forever, you can support the series at Patreon, a crowdfunding platform that allows you to support the content you love. Thank you to all of our patrons for making Crash Course possible with their continued support.